Good morning. It's kind of weird to have people applaud for you getting up. There's a lot that I'm getting used to this morning, but it's good. It is good to be with you here. Will you join your hearts with mine in prayer? Lord Jesus, as we have been saying, as we have been singing, we are here to love you and to receive the love that you had for us. So will you please use the meditations of my heart, the words that you have given, to do just that this morning, not because of anything in us, not because of anything in me, but because of the beautiful, wonderful, life-giving Lord that you are. And we know that you will, because you promised you would. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So one day, thousands of years ago, in a remote part of the world, a man who had been in construction all of his life was walking around the shore of a lake. He came across two men and he said to them, "Follow me." And Peter and Andrew left what they were doing and they followed. And so it went. For 3 years, this construction worker turned rabbi walked around inviting people to follow him. All kinds of people, from the richer to the poorer, the younger to the older, the lighter skinned to the darker skinned, the popular and the rejects, the engineers and the artists, men, women, children. He invited them all to follow him. And sometimes the people said yes. Sometimes they said no. The people who said yes, we know stuff about them. The people who said no, not so much. But the ones who said yes, have you ever noticed how interesting they are? This is a group of people that we know got corrected a lot. We know they would bicker back and forth while they supported one another. We know that at times they had wonderful joy and success, and at times they failed miserably. Are you feeling it yet? We know they asked a lot of questions, and in response, they got a lot of cryptic answers. In fact, a common experience for them was not understanding all that was going on. But still, they followed. They followed Jesus because in Jesus, something deep in their being, not just as individuals, but as a community, something was happening. It was happening to them. This man was so compelling that to be with Jesus was to be changed. He had an intelligence and a way of being in the world that was unlike any other. Even though he never had to sit for oral or written ordination exams, he knew what he was talking about. Who knew such a thing? In fact, it seemed like all of reality was being reshaped around him. Water turned to wine. Waves stilled in the ocean. Bodies stopped bleeding. Blind eyes started seeing. Evil spirits started fleeing. And so his followers had learned to live always asking, "What does that mean? What did you do that for?" That was their mood. That was their mindset. Because when it came to what is real, and what is right, and what is reliable, no one could touch Jesus. And as they followed, so much of their understanding about what it meant to do life with God was reshaped, including the ultimate purpose for which Jesus came. When he came and he said, "Follow me," he meant something by that. And the night of his arrest, as he was about to be betrayed, he prayed about that. And this is what he prayed. "Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you. And these know that you have sent me. I have made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them." Jesus is praying. He is asking that the glory he had with the Father before creation be seen by us and to be shared with us. He tells the Father to keep revealing that as he's going, he's gonna keep revealing the glory of God, the essence of the Father, Son, Spirit nature. He's gonna reveal the eternal heart of God in his response to all that is about to happen to him. So that the love he and the Father have always shared may be in us. That he may be in us. Jesus is praying that we will get swept into the love of the triune. He is beseeching the Father on our behalf that we will get caught up with him into this kind of love, triune love. That's the end game. Jesus is praying for us that we will have intimate knowledge of that love, intimacy with the triune. Is that how you tend to think about your relationship with Jesus? Is that how we describe our community life in Jesus? Is intimate a word that we would use for our life together in him? Dallas Willard said that persons are made up of experiences, and intimacy is a matter of shared experiences. Having experiences with the triune God. When you think about that, does it hyperlink you to Genesis 1 and 2? Right? Where God creates the heavens and the earth, and then he places his image bearers in Eden, in this place where the heavens and the earth, they overlap, and humans get to live there. Does it remind you about how in Eden, God walks with Adam and Eve, empowering them to embody his divine rule and presence and power and creativity in everything they do. His commissioning of them to create families and to cultivate a civilization that physically expresses the nature of the triune, that life-producing, outward-facing love of God that's always on the go because that's the kind of love it is. It spreads. You remember the four rivers in Eden? Yeah, those ancient transportation highways, right? They get thrown into the middle of the chapter as an image to remind us of the task given to us as his human agents to spread Eden out so that we can make all the earth bloom with the results of intimacy between God and humanity. Now, of course, the image bearers are lured into disobeying the word and the wisdom of God. And their intimacy is fractured. Humanity gets exiled out of the garden of life and into a land of dust and death. But God promised that our disobedience would not have the final word. And because of Jesus, it doesn't. Right? Because of Jesus, everything has changed. Jesus, who came into our dust and death-laden land, the one saturated with evil and aggression and oppression and greed, to a world full of people hungry for power, looking out for no other interest than their own, to a world full of anxious people wrestling with questions about meaninglessness and suffering, struggling to answer life's greatest questions like, who am I? Who are my people? What is my purpose? And can we even know any of those answers with verifiable truth? Jesus came and he authoritatively addressed these things. His followers saw him do it, saw him never lose sight of the fact that even though the world was a hot mess, which is Texan for total depravity, even though he was still in his Father's good world and he was safe in it. And so he dealt with our hot mess accordingly. And he commandingly overcame evil without engaging in it. And he did it in such a way that the results, his victory, can be transferred to us. He did it so that we can get back in on what we're created for. Life with God together as his beloved, cultivating life with him as we now truly and one day fully will live in the overlap of heaven and earth. Intimacy with the triune that breeds physical expressions of spiritual realities. That's what John's revelation in 21 is all about, right? That is what Paul is getting at in Ephesians 1. He says, this is what's happening in Jesus. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which is set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. Friends, when God raised Jesus from the dead, a new reality exploded into existence. One that opens the door for Jesus' followers together to experience triune love as a living reality, which then catalyzes a whole new way of being human in the world. One where we get to see that the triune's end game isn't simply to forgive people's sins so that they can get to heaven when they die. God's end game is more robust than that. It's to enable us to finally begin enacting what we were created for. In Christ, we are set free from sin for something. We have to be. Because freedom is never just for freedom's sake. Freedom is for an action's sake. You are freed from something for something. We are freed from triune love for being rooted and grounded in a love that surpasses knowledge, that is filled with all the fullness of God and joins Jesus in spreading his outward-facing, life-producing love on the go wherever we go, whether we are driving carpool or we are driving to the hoop, whether we are building spreadsheets or we are building houses, whether we are raising employment rates or we are raising children, whether we are composing music or we are composing invoices, we are Jesus' love on the go. So my husband and I, along with our friends Altus and Karin Kugelenberg, we are owners of a vineyard and a winery located in the heart of East Texas. Because that's what you do when God calls you to live in the Bible Belt, you make wine. And we agree this was a strange calling. And it's one we prayed long and hard over. It's one in which we are continually strategizing in how to make sure we are promoting the beauty of wine and we are deterring people from the drunkenness that can happen there. But I bring it up because in the wine world, there is a lot of talk about experience. I don't know if you know this, but you don't drink wine, you experience wine. Now, when John and I started out, we didn't know much about wine. We knew red, white. Kind of knew sweet, dry. We knew what sweet meant, weren't quite sure what dry meant, but as a counterpart to sweet, that gave you some insight there. But that's all we knew, and that was fine. And that's all many people knew. That's what many people, that's all they want to know. And that's fine too. But for us, over time, interacting with the vineyard and wine, it became so much more. It's become this experience by which you get to appreciate how amazing it is that God would make a world in which you can take fruit from one kind of stem, a plant stem, and you can interact with it and do certain things and make it this delightful thing that goes in another kind of stem, a glass stem. Because of the way God shaped creation, humans can interact with nature to cultivate the one thing into the other thing. And if you ever want to see someone light up, ask my husband about this. He will talk to you about the hexagonal shape of the molecules as they enable them to connect and form different types of alcohol. He will talk to you about the atmosphere in which the wine is grown, known as the terroir. You kind of learn French when you're in the wine world. He'll talk about the choices that the farmers and the winemakers make in the growing and the harvesting and the processing and the barrels and the bottling and the corking and the uncorking and the pouring and the swirling and the sniffing and the looking and the sipping and the sharing with friends. At its best, wine is about all of these things. It engages all five senses. It's much like a good meal. You know, when you treat food as something more than just fuel, it becomes a full sensory experience. It involves not just the taste buds, but the presentation of the food on the plate. Right? It involves the nose as the smell gets into your salivary glands. And they start producing before the food even gets to you. You know that it's asserted that 75 to 95% of taste comes through our nose. And so you have foodies in your life. You know, they find ways to interact with the food so that they can get it up into their nose. It involves touch. As certain textures enter your mouth, ones you enjoy and ones you want to immediately spit out. It involves sound. As meat sizzles on the grill, or as people hum with delight as they savor dark chocolate melting in their mouth. And it's about friendship. As you talk with your companions around the table about what you think the chef did to bring about the various textures and flavors, if you are willing to take the time for it, food and wine invite you to engage all the senses that God gave you, and in doing so, to give thanks to the God who made it possible. And if that is possible, with just one simple meal, if that can be a point of connection that breeds intimacy with God and other people, can you imagine all the pathways available to us for this? To live as new creatures, people whose very lives are shaped by a robust understanding of what God has in store for us. And friends, we, empowered by the Spirit of God, get to lead people in that, into experiencing and expressing the love of the triune, not only on church properties or short-term mission trips, which are great, but also in music and in architecture, and in business, and in coding, in philosophy, and in nursing, right? In collecting trash, and in coaching athletics, in our families, and our friendships, our colleagues, with our cousins, we get to be caught up in routinely doing and saying, in real life circumstances, the kinds of things Jesus did and said. And from its earliest days, followers of Jesus knew that to do this well, it would be important to have certain structures in place. So leaders of the Jesus communities would gather and they would ask themselves, what must we have in place in order for us to be us? And they would organize themselves accordingly. And so came about not only church communities, but schools and hospitals, all of these places where the love of God could be discovered. And that's what our work this week is all about, is it not? To facilitate our call to help people discover for themselves what it means to experience the robust fullness of who Jesus is. He's not just a sin remover, he is also a life giver. Someone who answers the deepest questions of our souls. Does what I do 40 hours a week really matter? Is what I'm building just gonna burn up? Is there gonna be someone who loves the real me long enough to stick around? Is there any coming back from the wrong I did? People are in crisis around us because they are so disconnected from solid answers to these questions. And church, we aren't helping when all we can say to their very personal and profound questions are the theological versions of red, white, sweet, dry. Our world desperately needs more. It needs the robustness of Jesus and what he's doing. Our people, our communities, our workplaces are dying from this. They need this. They need the more. And guess who has the more? We have the more, right? Those of us who are following Jesus, we are the more. And I know it is not always fun and easy to share the more. When you take the love of the triune on the go, the battle scars are real. Our resurrected Lord has the holes in his hands and his feet to prove it. But they're worth it. At the end of The Two Towers in Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings trilogy, there's a big battle. And one of the hobbits, Merry, is in the middle of the battle, and he's panicking. He's crawling around in the mud, and there are all these huge, evil warriors all around him, and he's afraid for his life, and so he's running scared. But suddenly he looks up, and he sees Eowyn standing, fighting, ready to die before the biggest and the baddest of the evil warriors. And in the book, it says, the slow kindled courage of his race awoke, and he looked at her, and he said, she should not die alone. And he got up, and he did his great deed. The next time that you are tempted to retreat from doing the hard work of ensuring that we have in place what needs to be there for us to be us. The next time you are tempted to let people settle for less than having a robust experience of the gospel in which all that they are is caught up into the love of the triune. The next time the battle gets real and you're getting scarred in the process, look at Jesus and say, he should not die alone. Amen. And in the fellowship of the Trinity, by the grace of God, go. Lord Jesus, these are the people that you have called us to be, the people you're empowering to be by your Spirit. We have you, we know you, and we are changed because of you. Lord, throughout our week, sharpen us. Enable us to be more than we ever could be alone. Connect us to who you are, to one another, that everyone throughout the world might know our Jesus. And we know that you will, because you promised you would. Amen.